It's been a while. Let's go take a drive. What is going on, guys? Metavert here, Lethal Garage, and today we are back in the Lethal Camaro, and we are gonna take a drive. This is a series, God, I did years ago. I started years ago, went for well over a year, and then I just stopped. I don't know why I stopped, but I'm gonna do a drive. I'm not gonna say I'm gonna commit and bring it fully back, but I wanna talk about driving a race car on the streets and what I would do differently and some of that stuff. So that's today's topic, that's today's conversation. I'm in the garage right now letting the car warm up because any built car needs to be warm before you go drive and tromp on it. So let's get her up to temp and see what she can do. Let's start off with the basics. If you guys aren't familiar, I have a 2016 Camaro. It started life as a 2SS. I probably took the completely wrong vehicle in regards to wanting to build a drag car. Initially, I was waffling between a kind of like a mountain cruiser slash road course slash drag car, and then I went all the way drag racing, which if I would have got a 1SS, or even now, if I was to start everything over now, the LT1 model would probably be the best bang for your buck car if you're going out to set up a drag car. So in my instance, I've gone through a lot of changes, a lot of different power adders, a lot of different fueling. I mean, the cool thing was is we were able to kind of document it as we went, and that was kind of the purpose. I started off that way on purpose, but if I was to go back and rewind and do it all over again, there is a certain way I would do it, and I'm gonna talk about that. But overall, the car sits right now with a Whipple 2.9 liter supercharger. It does have cam, does have built bottom end, basically the whole internal structure of the block. Well, the block is stock and the crank is stock. Everything else has been replaced. Running Frankenstein ED head, stage 3, awesome product. Running Stainless Works long tube, 2-inch setup, running full Stainless Works out the back with the original or classic exhaust. Right now it is in tour mode. That's sport mode. I don't know if that difference is gonna come across in the camera there, but if you did hear it, there is a difference for sure. I'll go back into tour. But right now I'm letting the car warm up. We have LPE high side pump. We have fuel injector connection, high flow injectors. We're running C16 fuel currently, but we're going back to 85. We're gonna be adding methanol to the car. I'm missing a lot of stuff. Rotofat, big gulp intake. I got the Nick Williams 103. We have the DSS drive shaft and axles. Yeah, I mean, the car is, for all intents and purposes, built. I'm in a Kirky seat. I got a full 8.5 second roll cage. It's mostly hidden. And if you guys seen the video, obviously you can see the bar here, but the upper bar's hidden, the front bars, the back bars, they're all hidden. I think they did a really good job. Worked out really well. Unfortunately, the person who did my cage kind of got into trouble and not doing what he promised for other people, and it's really unfortunate, so I refuse to advertise him or call out his name. So if you're asking me who did my cage, I won't tell you. Outside of that, let's go for a drive. So currently cruising in tour mode through my neighborhood. My car's pretty dang loud, especially out the backside. If you're standing in the front, it really doesn't sound that bad. But windows are down. There's gonna be a lot of people walking around. So I'm gonna go out to the wine country today and we'll do this video. So hopefully we can get on it a little bit, see what she can do. It's been a while since I've taken it out. So that's what we're gonna do today. We're gonna take it out. Traction control off. Someone's Tesla died up over here yesterday. Must have ran out of power. It's getting a tow now. So still cruising in tour mode, but man, she accelerates. Running a 3.2 upper pulley, 9.1 lower, which is about 15.25 pounds of boost. So we don't have her all the way cranked up right now. That's where we're going. The ultimate goal is to get her up to 21 PSI, really push it, see what we can do with the Whipple, and combine that with the methanol to combat the fueling issues, because we will be out of fuel system on the high side. A lot of guys are going down the route of adding a secondary high, a DI pump. I don't like the structure, and the people I know that have been messing with them, they've had issues with the belts jumping off, and that's not good at all. Tour mode, so the valves are closed right now. guys may or might not know, if you're new to the channel, originally Pro Charged the car with the smaller Pro Charger setup, the P1C or P1D or whatever it was. It was the smallest one at the time. They didn't have the P1X until actually took off the Pro Charger, which was supposed to be the better version. And then they have the D series and the F1A series and all that stuff. Pro Chargers are great systems. You can drive your car completely stock as if you don't have a blower in the lower RPM range. And then if you chomp on it, the power is there, you have a good time, and you know, there's some really fast cars running Pro Chargers right now. That being stated, I opted for the Whipple. I wanted the low end power, the low end torque. I wanted to be in it right away. And would I change that? I don't know. For drag racing, it definitely was a challenge for about a year plus. We spent well over a year combating, trying to get the car to launch because it just made way too much power off the line. We didn't have that power or problem with a Pro Charger. But now with a proper converter that Red Barn Racing spec'd out from FTI, we have no problems anymore. So a lot of it was the spec of the converter. I had a really good brand product converter, it just wasn't spec'd right for my build. So Circle D was a great product, but now I'm running an FTI setup and the car just, it wants to hook and go. So as we turn it up, we'll see what kind of issues we still run into. But as of right now, she drives pretty well. So kind of going back a little bit, a lot of questions I get from people, you know, people who go all in A and then they start talking about, okay, now I need to upgrade my fuel system. I want to add a supercharger, but I want to stay on E85. It's really wonky with the LT4 setups because direct injection is a great technology until you hit the limits of the high side pump, and then you start running into issues of needing more injector, needing more actual fuel, so having to do a cam swap. A lot of people don't realize that you have to change your cam and get a bigger fuel lobe so you can get more of that fuel demand on that high side setup. And then you can go with the like the LPE big bore setup, which flows even more fuel, which you can even go a bigger fuel lobe. I'm running a 38 fuel lobe on my cam right now. We are asking for every drop of fuel we can get. Most people won't run that. Red Barn Racing specifically spec'd it out that way. Mike knows what he's doing, set it up just properly. Car's running like a champ. So we're gonna go back to 85. The problem is again, we'll run out of high side fuel system again, and we're gonna compensate with methanol. So a lot of people will do that. A lot of people do that on the lower end to stop from having to spend thousands upon thousands of dollars of doing cam swap, doing fuel system injectors and all that kind of stuff, because it is an easier route to go cost-wise. Will you be happy in the long run? If you're a power chaser like I've become, you're gonna end up paying for all that stuff anyway. So my recommendation, save the pennies, build your fuel system right, and then if you get to the point where you need methanol, then go methanol. That little Nissan just did a hard break and launched. So I'm gonna put her in track mode now. They are doing road construction out here, so it's a little bumpy. Now we're gonna drive behind a slow Lexus. Not because it's a slow car, but because they're driving it slow. So overall, like if you're planning on doing a build, say, like I get a lot of people like, hey man, do I need to upgrade my fuel system to run E85 on my 6th Gen SS? No, you don't. If you have full bolt-ons and you want to run E85, you can do that no problem without having to touch your fuel system. It's once you go beyond that, if you add a cam, then you potentially need fueling. The first thing that most people have to do, you have to do the LT4 high side pump and the LT4 injectors. That's going to get you up to the 700 range in power, no problem. And that will solve a lot of issues, but then you run into the problem of needing a cam to be able to get there. So if you haven't done a cam, cams are a lot more expensive in a 6th gen setup than they are in the 5th gen, just because they're a lot more involved to get to, take a heck of a lot more time, and even the parts are more expensive for a full kit if you want good quality parts. I know Red Barn Racing, they offer cam kits and all, it's about just shy of $4,000 tuned full install, and that's with high-end Brian Tully Racing parts, all new replacement springs and valve, like all that stuff's done. Other shops obviously have their pricing and whatnot. Hit up your local shop, see what you're gonna do. If you guys are here in SoCal, Red Barn Racing can definitely take care of you in that. And that that being stated, that's going to get you into that range. Then you start, if you want more power, then you start getting into the big bore high side, DSX low side, or you could do what a lot of shops are doing and add methanol. There's a lot of shops out there that don't know the LT4 platforms like a lot of tuners out there. There's some that really know them, and there's some that don't. You know, like a great example is Sam from Amped, AMP, if you don't know Amp. They hold most of the records for stock internal vet. So if you're wondering why I'm not opening it up, because I have open roads, there's always cops right here, and I'm not risking it. But like Sam from Amp, I really like Mike from Red Barn. There's a lot of other guys out there that really know these LT platforms, know how to squeak a lot of horsepower out of them, and build them properly. You know, they're not trying to hide things. They're not trying to, you know, throw meth on top of it just because they can't figure out the tune. They look at all sorts of items and dial in the car right. Now, as far as suspension and all that kind of stuff goes, it's really the sky's the limit. I had iBox springs. This car does have MagRide on it, so adding through its own curveball issues on its own right, is that the best setup for drag racing? No, but we put stock suspension back on the car with the 15-inch conversion kit from Carlisle, and the car launches. It squats, it launches, the nose comes up. We had all sorts of problems getting the nose to come up for a long time when I had the iBox springs on, and the car was lowered. It was designed, and I had it set up to be a nice looking street car, and it was not set up for drag racing. And that was something we had to resolve real quick, and we did. And wow, there's a horse here. I'm probably scaring the heck out of it. Not what I would want. Horse-drawn carriage in the middle of the road out in the wine country. Come on, van. Now this van is stopping in the middle of the road. Awesome. Holy cow. So, where was I at? Suspension wise. So, we broke a drive shaft early on, and we knew it was gonna happen. The stock drive, I've seen guys break stock drive shafts with stock power. You know, it's like, did you get a drive shaft? Ryan Cunningham put it quite nicely one day. He's like, you probably got a drive shaft that was built on a Friday. And I kind of laughed at that, but it's true. You know, you never know if these stock parts are gonna last. I've seen LT1 motors, fresh stock, no mods, blow up, break a rod, all that stuff. I've heard the horror stories and everything. Can it happen to you? Heck yeah. Can it happen to a built car? Heck yeah. I think a lot of people don't realize that. But in this, we went the DSS chromoly drive shaft. I've seen issues with the aluminum ones. I've definitely seen a ton of issues with carbon fiber. I mean, if your car is a dedicated track car and you only take it to the track, carbon fiber might be the route you go, especially if you're going, you know, full effort car, trying to save every bit of ounce of weight possible. But I've seen too many carbon fiber drive shafts turn to confetti over the years. And, you know, if you want to run it, more power to you, but be very careful in that route. Axle-wise, we had an issue when the drive shaft broke. It took out one of the axles. We sent them back to DSS, drive shaft shop, almost said DSX. And they rebuilt them, haven't had any problems since. The car's just, it's been really good since then. So again, you buy a really high-end product and it can fail, but it was a failure because of the drive shaft. There's all that power, drive shaft snapped, and we think it just overturned the axle the wrong way and just caused a problem. So it's something that can't happen. That was six gear pull. That's why it sounded like it took forever to wind up. Downside is I did make the choice to go with C16, and that had me not driving my car. It just, I wasn't. And that was primarily because C16 is so gosh darn expensive. Staying with the 85 and going methanol, I'll be able to drive the car a heck of a lot more. A pail of methanol is pretty cheap in comparison to regular fuel or C16 fuels and stuff like that. And E85 is dirt cheap right now. So overall, C16 was fun. I'm glad we went down that journey and that path. Got to, you know, some learnings and understandings of how that fuel works. Definitely hates all your sensors, and lead eats them all away, and it will kill your bank account if you don't like $100 per 5 gallons at a time. If you guys follow me on Instagram, you saw me literally put the last pail into the car, and I think this is the last time I'm driving the car with C16, because I'm literally going to go back to the house, rip off the passenger side fender, and we're going to get ready to install the meth kit so we can go E85. So we'll have to drain the fuel tank and all that stuff, get E85 in there, and we'll do a separate video on all of that. But overall, it was a good experience. But you know, if I was to redo it all again, I probably would have just stayed E85 and should have added a methanol kit early on. A lot of people told me to do that, but I was like, you know what? I really want to see what C16 will do. I'm a May Taurus birthday guy, and I'm stubborn, so I stuck with my stubbornness, and yeah, it is what it is. So, and cars are stopping in the middle of the road. Design and aesthetics. You know, it's such an odd item to talk about because it's very subjective. What I like, you may not like, and what you like, I might not like. And I set up my car originally how I liked, the most aggressive look that I liked. I didn't swap out the front end to be a ZL1, and I kind of sad that I didn't because I really do like the way the ZL1 looks, but at the end of the day, I'm also glad I didn't because I'm a drag racer, and the drag race front end of a ZL1, it's not really, I mean, can you do it? Heck yeah. But are you going to get a lot more drag on a ZL1 front end than an SS front end? Yeah. So I'm glad I stuck with the SS setup. I did recently swap out the hood. I have the Anderson composite A to Z hood. You guys could still save 20% off if you guys want to check it out. I'll put my coupon code down below in the description. I added the Anvil Auto. I really like the notch spoiler on the 5th gen. Added it here on the 6th gen when they released it. I was like, I gotta get this. Ordered it right away. I got one of the first ones, which was awesome, and did a video on it if you guys aren't familiar with it. But I really like the way it looks on the car, and I think it's a great product in addition for the 6th generation aftermarket. But again, it's subjective. Not everyone's gonna like it. Some people like the high wing, some people like different designs. It is what it is. I've ran a lot of different spoilers on this car. The stock spoiler, I had the high wing spoiler, I had the ACS composite spoiler, and now I have the Anvil spoiler. I've also done kind of the same thing with wheels. I had my stock wheels, I had MRR FS01s, and then the 1LE M017 1LE replicas, and then I went with HRE FF04s, and then I refinished those a couple times, and now I'm on my full-time drag pack with Weld wheels, which was a design I don't like. Like, I have the S77s, I would like to change them to a different design, but man, beadlocks are expensive. So yeah, I've just been rocking this design because I like it, and people know the car because of these wheels at this point. So maybe one day I'll switch them to something else, but my focus has been on the 71 for extra funds. So until we swap back over, it is what it is. So one of the big controversial items that I do run in the car is my inner chiller. A lot of people don't think inner chillers work, and there's a lot of people out there that will swear by them. I can only tell you what I've experienced in IAT-wise. My car used to overheat like crazy. It did. It just got really, really hot. And once we put the inner chiller on, it resolved all those problems. Now, is an inner chiller the only way to do that? No. You could always do an ice bucket and all that stuff and solve the problems that way. Am I happy I went with the inner chiller? Yeah, I am. It was something new. I mean, we were one of the first 6th gens that had a kit on the car from Australia. It's actual Force Induction Inner Chillers, the company that makes them. They're from Australia. And it's a high quality product, and it's a huge brick, unlike some of the other products on the aftermarket. They're much smaller little baby bricks, so guys are having to run two of them to get their temps down. But right now, it's 98 degrees outside, and my IATs are 73. not bad. I mean, considering my oil temps to, no, where is it? 194, and air intake temp is 87. So it's definitely dropping the temps. And when I hit the gas and I really tromp on it, the temps drop. So let's see. Yeah, it dropped down to 68. So it's working. It's doing what it's supposed to do. And then on top of that, once we add methanol, it's really gonna work. It's gonna be crazy to see how an inner chiller, methanol, and 85 all work in tandem to get us the best setup. And it's, I mean, it's unfortunate. There's like three cars in front of me driving under the speed limit. Well, that sucked. My battery died as I was getting behind those three slow cars. And so I had to run back to the Lethal Garage, get a new battery, and now we are hitting the road. And I was just in an area where I was gonna do some pulls. And yeah, so we're gonna head back out there and go do some pulls. News on the 2021 Camaros coming out with the new red color.